The Whistler.
I am the Whistler, and I know many things, for I walk by night. I know many strange tales, hidden in the hearts of men and women who have stepped into the shadows. Yes, I know the nameless terrors of which they dare not speak.
Tonight, transcribed, it's the Whistler's strange story, Lady in Waiting.
Her own feelings didn't match the day at all. It was spring in San Francisco, and the city had a way of catching the spirit of such occasions. Even Eddy Street and the rather dismal office building she was entering seemed to brighten up somehow. She paused near a flight of stairs, her eyes examining the directory. A few minutes later, a secretary ushered her into attorney John Bradley's office.
Sit down, Miss Collins.
Thank you.
You seem nervous. Is there something...
It's just that I'm not sure you can help me, Mr. Bradley. And no one else knows what I'm about to tell you.
No one else will, whether I handle the case or not. Now, does that make it easier?
Yes, much. Well, it's quite simple in a way, the facts, I mean. You see, I was keeping company with someone a number of months ago, a very fine man. At least, I thought he was.
Go on.
I wasn't in love with him, but he was kind, thoughtful, and very much in love with me. I only tell you that so you'll understand.
I do understand.
Anyway, he wanted me to marry him. He said we'd go away, travel around the world for a few years. He kept talking about that. I'm afraid that waiting for me to give him an answer is what kept him here.
Well, the case isn't too unusual yet, Miss Collins.
I haven't told you his name. It was Frank Hardison.
Hardison? Not the one who...
Yes. Believe me, I didn't know any more about that part of his life than anyone else. He never told me. And to meet him, Mr. Bradley, you'd never guess. He was a perfect gentleman. I'd never met anyone.
He got 20 years, didn't he?
Yes.
I remember reading about it. Quite a list of charges. You doubt his guilt, is that it? Want me to...
No, Mr. Bradley, that isn't it.
Then...
Well, every month, in the mailbox at my apartment, I find an envelope filled with a currency, large bills.
That's a problem.
You don't understand. I know that somehow Frank's sending that money. I want it stopped. I haven't touched a cent of it. I don't want to. But I thought if a lawyer talked to him, explained to Frank that he's really doing more harm than good. I have a very responsible position, Mr. Bradley. If the people I work with ever saw...
Of course. Now, why don't you go home and forget it, Miss Collins? I'll handle it. I'll drive up and see Hardison tomorrow.
Thank you. When will I know? I'll be terribly anxious.
Could you meet me here about, say, 4 o'clock?
No, I'm sorry. See, I'm with an advertising agency, Mr. Bradley. And we have an important meeting with a client this afternoon.
Then why not meet me after hours at the El Prado Bar? 6 o'clock.
All right.
And I'll have all the answers for you.
I hope so.
It's easier now, isn't it, Jim? Now that your problem is being shared, and somehow you feel a sense of confidence in attorney John Bradley. Riding home in a cab, you hope that it will go as simply as Bradley seems to anticipate. In front of the Rexford Arms, you're suddenly aware that the cab has stopped, that the doorman is smiling at you, waiting for you to step out.
You with us, Miss Jean?
What? Oh, I'm sorry, Daddy. Dreaming again. Here you are, driver.
Fine spring day like this, man. You should leave that desk of yours, get outside, go for a walk through Golden Gate Park. Nothing like being outdoors.
Dan, you're wonderful. How are you feeling?
Oh, I'm all right.
You think you should work like this, Dan?
It's outdoors. doctor says that's where I gotta be.
All right. Just worried about you.
There should be more like you, Miss Jean. And from the way you looked and acted the past few days, I guess you've got things in your own mind.
Dan, there should be more like you to notice. It's just a business worry, Dan. And I think it will all be cleared up tomorrow night.
To Miss Collins, to no more worries and an uninhibited future.
Oh, Mr. Bradley, I'm so glad it went that way.
Hey, you're not drinking.
Oh, I really don't feel like it. I'm just happy that Frank didn't give you any trouble, that he understood.
Oh, he did, perfectly. And you're right. Hardison's a nice guy. But you still have a problem.
Oh?
Yourself. The way you've been brooding about all this. Can I help you forget it some way?
How?
No. Good start might be a steak dinner at Julius's castle. You can look down at the city and tell it that Jean Collins isn't going to worry anymore about anything.
I shouldn't.
You should. You can even pay for it if you like. I'll be your first charity.
What do you mean?
All that money that's accumulated. Hardison doesn't want it back. He hasn't much use for it. He suggests that you deduct my fee and give the rest to your favorite charity.
Oh.
And my fee includes a steak dinner. Fair enough? Then I'll drive you straight home.
All right. Fair enough, Mr. Bradley.
Jean, right to the door.
Mr. Bradley, you've been so wonderful.
John?
Oh, John. You've been very kind, and I do appreciate it.
Your favorite lawyer, huh?
Absolutely.
Will I see you soon?
Oh, well, I don't know.
Jean.
Yes?
Get in trouble again right away, will you? I'll handle it.
Oh, idiot. Good night.
I'll call you. Good night.
Evening, Miss Jean.
Hello, Dan.
Well, the spring day's kept alive into the night. You're happy, Miss Jean.
Yes. Good night, Dan.
Good night.
Dan. Dan, you're not really very well, are you?
Oh, no.
Please, I want to know if you had some money, quite a bit of money, is there any doctor that could help you?
Miss Jean, there should be more like you. Ma'am, I'll not forget this.
Tell me, then.
I'll tell you this. A long time ago, I had all the care a man could have. It's no good. I'm just standing by the door now, waiting my turn.
I'm sorry.
Don't be. Forget it, Miss Jean. Only I won't ever forget you.
Good night, Dan.
Dan's right, isn't he? The spring day has kept alive into the night. You see a great deal of John Bradley in the days that follow. Evenings at the theater, dining and dancing at the Smart Club. And you find yourself becoming extremely fond of him. You look forward to each meeting with increasing interest. Then one evening, you say goodnight to John in the lobby of your apartment building and go upstairs. And as you're about to open your apartment door...
Just a minute, Jean.
What?
I'm going in with you.
Stay here.
Inside. I'm Frankie's old partner, Jean. I don't like the way he's running our business, so I'm changing things a little. First, get your checkbook. Write out the full amount of Frankie's donation.
But you can't ask me.
I'm not asking. I'm telling you. I'll tell you something else. You better forget your boyfriend.
Mr. Bradley.
John. He's out. Crossed off your book. You mustn't see him anymore. He might get hurt.
Well, he's done nothing.
Not yet. But I don't like you hanging around lawyers. your Frank's girl.
But...
Here's my pen. You can write that check out now to your favorite charity, Joey Stark.
In just a minute, The Whistler will continue tonight's story. All of us are proud of our hometowns, and rightly so. In this brief moment before we continue with our program, we'd like to offer a salute to one of our hometowns in America, Des Moines, Iowa. Its history dates back over 100 years to the time when Fort Des Moines was established at the junction of the Raccoon and Des Moines Rivers to protect the rights of various Indian tribes in the prairie region. The city today, largest in the state and the state capital, is surrounded by rich coal fields which have contributed greatly to its industrial development. If you carry insurance on your home, the chances are that your premiums wind up in Des Moines, since over 150 insurance companies have offices in the city. And manufacturing is important here, too. Over a third of $1 billion worth of its products are sold throughout the world every year. Such things as cosmetics, chemicals, medicine, wearing apparel, tools, machinery, food products, airplane parts, and many others. It's a city of churches, over 200 of various denominations. A city of parks, over 1,600 acres of natural beauty spots. A city of culture with many fine art institutions. The people of Des Moines are proud of their hometown and proud of the way Des Moines has taken its place in the building of America. And now, back to The Whistler.
Vanished in an instant, didn't it, Susan? The hope for a bright, clean future. Joey Stark, Frank Hardison's partner, won't believe that you don't know what was going on, have no knowledge of the sort of deals that sent Frank to prison for 20 years. More than that, Susan, he insists that you stop seeing John Bratton. And for the next 3 days, you're afraid to even talk to him, even on the telephone. The terrible part is the realization that you love John, isn't it? That you don't want to give him up. An hour later, you'll find a note downstairs in the mailbox. Orders from Mr. Joey Stark to meet him tonight. You'll hurry downtown to your office.
Hello, Jean.
John, you shouldn't have come
here. I'm staying right here until you talk to me, until you tell me what's wrong. Close the door.
But... it's nothing, John.
Why have you refused to see me? Why aren't you in when
John,
I called? You even have the doorman at your apartment making excuses when I know he's lying. Jean, if it's something I've done...
No, no, you haven't done anything. Someone called on me. A man, Frank's partner.
Oh?
He won't believe that I don't know about Frank. His name is Joey Stark. That's all I can tell you. I'm meeting him. Tonight.
No, you're not. I'll meet him, talk to him, like I did with Frank.
No.
Please, Jean, now be careful. Now, tell me where you were supposed to meet him.
There's a note. I have it in my purse. It's all there. A hotel on Ella Street.
When you get through here, go home. Wait for me to call. Don't open the door or talk to anyone.
John, you will be careful.
I'll handle it. Just wait until I call.
Yes?
Jean?
John? Are you all right?
There's nothing to worry about.
You sorry?
Jean, this call goes to a switchboard, doesn't it?
Yes.
They better not talk anymore. I'll come by in the morning before you go to work. In the meantime...
Yes?
No matter what you might hear... remember, there's nothing to worry about. Nothing at all. Not now.
John, I've been so anxious. Who are you?
Lieutenant Williams, homicide. This is Sergeant Knowles. May we come in, Miss Collins?
Homicide? I don't understand. understand.
There's some things we don't understand, Miss Collins. Well, can we talk it over?
Come in. Sit down.
Now, that won't be necessary. I'll come right to the point, Miss Collins. Tell me, is this your check?
Oh, yes. Yes, it is. Where did you get it?
We found it on the body of a man tentatively identified as Joey Stark.
The body?
That's right. He was found late last night. Brought into the morgue. Took us a little while to look you up, but naturally we're interested in learning the connection between you and this man. Now, this check, it's for quite a sum.
Please, I don't know anything about it. Of course I wrote the check, but...
But what? Did you go to this man's hotel at any time last night?
No.
Didn't leave your apartment here, I suppose.
I didn't go there, I tell you. I was supposed to, but... something happened, changed my mind.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Noel, get that doorman and bring him up here. We'll see if he's got a memory. Now, Miss Collins, why don't you tell me what this is all about? Blackmail setup?
No. I tell you, I don't...
Well, expecting someone?
No. Whoever gets us in the way.
No, I wouldn't do that, Miss Collins. We'll both see who it is. He's quite insistent. All right, go ahead. Open the door.
Come on, I can't see you now. You can drive me to the office some other time.
Well, Johnny Bradley. Lieutenant Williams. What are you doing?
Well, you lost little time in calling a lawyer, Miss Collins. And a good one, too. We'll come to this boy. Oh, come in.
Dean, how long have you been here? What have you told him?
Oh, I work fast, Bradley. You know that. You told me all I want to know. Namely, that this is her check.
Check? What about it?
John, they found it on Joey Stark's body.
Say, you folks talk real familiar about Joey. You know him too, Bradley?
Maybe. Why shouldn't he have Miss Collins' check? She gave it to him as a favor for someone.
Really? Who?
What difference does it make?
None. If she didn't leave this apartment last night. And we'll know that in a minute. Oh, bring him right in, Noel.
What is all this? Miss Jean, is there
something? I'll ask the questions, if you don't mind, Dan. You see, we're trying to find out if Miss Collins went to a certain address last night. Now, it's to her advantage for you to tell the truth.
Doesn't it?
Did you notice her leave the building around 9 o'clock, like she says? I'm asking him, Miss Collins. Well, Dan, did she?
Miss Collins never left the building at all last night. I worked very late. I had seen her.
Mm-hmm. Well, Miss Collins, if I don't doubt you and your witness, I think a jury might.
What do you mean?
Dan Rogers here. Yeah, I have a very good memory. Now, let me see. Convicted of perjury in 1929, weren't you, Dan?
What?
Mm-hmm. Paroled for good behavior. Brought back on the same charge in 1932. Served 5 years. Yes, a nice, reliable witness.
All right. So what are you going to do?
Same thing you'd do in my position, Bradley. I'm arresting your client, Miss Collins, on suspicion of murder.
You've got your murderer, Williams. But it isn't Miss Collins. I did it.
What?
You heard me. I did it. I killed him. Well, if you don't believe me, pick up a cab driver who drove me over there last night.
You mean out of all the cabs in San Francisco, you...
His number is 4211. I made a note of it. Get him. You remember me. We had trouble finding the address.
You know what this means, Bradley?
Yeah. I know what it means.
Be half right. Use USAFE. For example, do you know how much of our land has been permanently ruined by erosion because of improper farming? Would you say 25 million acres? No, that's only half right. Brush up on your conservation. Tell your I&E officer you want to study with the United States Armed Forces Institute, USAFE. It's easy. It's simple. If you don't want to be half right, use USAFE. And now, back to The Whistler.
happened, hasn't it, Gene? All that you feared from that very first day when you decided that someone might be able to help you in your problem with Frank Hardison. It's clear, isn't it? Don Bradley murdered Stark for you. Confessed to Lieutenant Williams to save him. And now a cab driver is about to prove John's story.
Yep. I drove him to the hotel about 9 p.m.
That's right.
Oh, John, John, why didn't you let
him? Did you wait while he went up to Stark's room, driver?
No, he went up, though. Saw him walk through the lobby and start up the stairs. Picked up another fare and drove off.
Mm, I see.
Isn't that all, Lieutenant?
Yeah, you can go. I'll, you too, Dan.
Hey.
Hmm?
Wait a minute.
What's the matter?
My other fare. Who's this man?
Dan.
Sure, the old guy here. He come walking out of the hotel as Mr. Bradley went in. Passed him.
So that's it, Bradley. Stark was dead when you got there, wasn't he? You lied because you thought that Miss Collins had killed him.
Dan, you killed him. But why?
Wait a minute, Gene. You shouldn't talk in front of the police. Dan, let me
Don't worry about it, son. If they put me on trial, the jury better not stay out too long. Miss Gene, it wasn't just for you. It was for Frank, too.
Frank?
Frank Hardison put me on that door downstairs the day you moved in here. I left the envelopes and stopped leaving them. Whatever Frank said.
Dan, you once said that someone else paid some medical expenses for you. Was it Frank?
Yes, Miss Jane.
So, that's why you...
This Joey Stark was no friend of Frank's. He was just a cheap hoodlum blackmailing Miss Jane.
But Dan, to kill a man. Just to pay back a...
It wasn't only that, Mr. Bradley. The lieutenant here will be able to show you when he checks on all those aliases of mine. He'll find one of them was Hardison.
Hardison?
You see, Frank Hardison is my boy. Miss Jean, he asked me to protect you. You were the one decent thing that ever happened to him.
Now, a question. Do you know the story behind the phrase, I have not yet begun to fight? In 1778, John Paul Jones set sail for America in command of the old sea-battered ship Bonhomme Richard. Off the English coast, he encountered the English 50-gun frigate Serapis. In the furious battle which followed, half the crew of the Bonhomme Richard were killed and most of the others threatened a mutiny. But despite these setbacks, when the English captain demanded his surrender, Jones answered, I have not yet begun to fight. A short time later, the English ship struck her flag and was boarded by the American crew as their own ship went down. This is but one of many interesting facts which can be found in the history of your United States Navy.
Featured in tonight's transcribed story were Bill Foreman as the Whistler, John Stevenson, Lorene Tuttle, Herb Butterfield, Jim Nutter, Bill Boucher, and Jack Moyle. The Whistler, directed by Gordon P. Hughes, with music by Wilbur Hatch, is written and produced by Joel Malone and transmitted overseas by the Armed Forces Radio Service. The Whistler was entirely fictional, and all characters portrayed on The Whistler are also fictional. Any similarities of names or resemblances to persons living or dead is purely coincidental. This is George Walsh speaking and reminding you to listen again next week for another strange tale by The Whistler.